Yeah, thank you very much. Also thank you for the organizers for inviting me to this nice conference. And I'm very happy to be here again after 2 years. I want to talk about small solutions of quadratic congruences, some topic which has received already quite some amount of attention. Let me first start with some motivation. Let Q be a quadratic form with integer coefficients. And let's assume that we consider integer arguments. There's an abundance of results about the representations of integers by quadratic forms. Particularly interesting are ternary quadratic forms. I will return to this point later in this talk. One famous theorem states the following, a theorem by Meyer. If the number of variables is greater or equal 5, and Q is indefinite and non-degenerate, then it represents 0 non-trivially. There's also a continuous counterpart of this result, the famous Oppenheim conjecture, but for the number of variables greater or equal 3. It's famously established using ergodic methods by Margulis. So it says the following: if Q has real coefficients and is not a multiple of a form with rational coefficients, and is indefinite and non-degenerate, then the set of values is dense in R as the variables run over integers. As a connection to the problem which I consider, I will make this link later. In fact, there are also quantitative versions of this Oppenheim conjecture for n greater or equal 5, the circle method can be applied. So Davenport and Heilbronn have old result for quadratic forms in 5 variables. Okay. In fact, we came from this problem because I was attracted to the Oppenheim conjecture and tried to get a p-adic analog in some sense. Okay, so now it's certainly interesting to consider the same problem in, of representations of 0 in ZQ. Meaning to look at quadratic congruences. So here, one is interested in questions like, do we have some equidistribution results as Q tends to infinity? Or can we say something in particular about small solutions? One interesting question is to single out small solutions or to establish the existence of small solutions. Yeah, so our question becomes the following, given the modulus, how large does one need to choose n to guarantee the existence of a non-zero solution of the congruence Q x1 up to xn, congruence zero modulo Q, where the height is less or equal n. So the maximum of the moduli of the variables is less or equal n. And also, how do the solutions distribute? Can we prove some equidistribution result, some asymptotic formula for the number of solutions? Yeah, so this problem has received also quite a lot of attention. Let me state some results in this direction. First of all, Schinzel, Schlickewey, and Schmidt proved a general result for quadratic forms in n greater or equal 3 variables with arbitrary coefficients. So they don't need to be fixed. They can vary with Q. They proved, in particular, their result for the case of n equals 3, which we want to look at in this talk, implies that the maximum of x1, x2, x3 is O of Q to the 2/3 with an absolute O constant, not depending on the coefficients. So then there is interesting work by Heath Brown, who looked at square free moduli. Okay. Also he restricted to odd moduli. And okay, non-singular quadratic forms with respect to Q. That means the determinant is co-prime to Q. He improved this exponent 2/3 to 5/8. So we will see that 1/2 is a natural barrier, or yeah, that we cannot do better than 1/2, in fact. But so what one would expect is 1/2, in fact. In fact, in an earlier version of the talk slides, I hit there 3/5, but it's 5/8. So yeah. So I need to resend my talk slides. Good. Yeah, what happens if we have a fixed coefficient? So we start with some quadratic form. Like, for example, you can take Pythagorean triplets modulo Q. So x1 square plus x2 square minus x3 square. Homo and zero modulo Q. Yeah, in this case, yeah, good, that's actually not very interesting. I come to this case, to this particular case. But so if you have fixed coefficients, let's say 1, 1, 1 or whatever, 1, 1, -1, you can replace the 2/3 by 1/2. But the more interesting question is what happens if we allow the coefficients to vary with Q. Then there is also previous work on the particular case of prime powers, which is kind of orthogonal to the situation of Heath Brown, who considered square free moduli. Hakimi got the results on quadratic forms with a large number of variables. So in a sense, large compared to the modulus in a certain sense. Okay. So now this is joint work with my PhD student, Arno Palda. Yeah, so we looked at diagonal quadratic forms with three variables and tried to study the distribution of solutions, small solutions, modulo Q, where Q is a prime power. So the orthogonal situation to Heath Brown's setup. We made one more natural condition, namely we only consider x1, x2, x3, which are co-prime to Q. That's to avoid yeah, trivial solutions. Like, for example, you can take, when you have Q equals P to the 2n, you can take P to the n, P to the n, P to the n, which is already of a square root size, size of the square root of the modulus. So we want to avoid these situations and take this condition of coprimality to the modulus. Also, we assume for simplicity that the coefficients are co-prime to the modulus. Yeah, in fact, Heath Brown pointed out something when he gets the existence of non-zero solutions, less Q to the theta, where theta is greater than 1/2. Then one gets it easily. Yeah, if one gets that for the square free moduli, one gets it easily for all moduli by a very simple argument. Let's just write Q in the form Q0 square, Q1, where Q1 is square free. Then when you have a solution x1, x2, x3 for the congruence Q, x1, x2, x3, congruence zero modulo Q1, then automatically Q of, yeah, all of x1, x2, x2, x3 multiplied with q0 is a solution modulo q, trivially. But this argument fails if we make this restriction of coprimality of the variables with the modulus q. Because, yeah, so when we are in the situation of a prime power p to the n, then q0 will itself be a power of p. In particular, if n is odd, then simply we get q is equal to, yeah, I mean, let's see, n is 2k plus 1, then we get q0 equals p to the k, q1 equal to p. And even easier, if q is p to the 2n, then we get q1 is equal to 1 and q0 is equal to p to the n. Okay, so by making this restriction to, co-prime x1, x2, x3, co-prime to the modulus, we cannot apply this. Simple argument and things are more complicated and more interesting. Good, so we get first our main results in this direction. So what we did was first we smooth out the problem and it becomes easier to apply things like Poisson summation. So we assume that phi is a Schwarz class function. We assume also p is greater than 5, just to avoid the situation that we have no solution at all to the quadratic congruence. So when p is greater than 5, then we have necessarily solutions. Okay, and then we consider this quantity. We run with x1, x2, x3 over the integers, co-prime to p, satisfying this congruence. Summing over these smooth, the product of these smooth weight functions. And we can establish some asymptotic for that, for a fixed form, provided that the range of the variables is greater or equal q to the 1/2 plus epsilon. So a little bit larger than the square root of the modulus. Important here is we have fixed from the beginning the integers alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, the coefficients of the quadratic form. And we let n tend to infinity. More interesting is the situation when we, let's talk a little bit about this quantity, quantity Cp on the right-hand side can be written explicitly in that form. So it depends on Legendre symbols. Okay. So more interesting is the situation when we don't fix the coefficients, but we take actually the maximum over the smallest solution as alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3 vary over the possible coefficients, modulo q. So then, so the task is to beat the exponent 2/3, which was mentioned earlier in this paper by Schmidt, Schlickewey, Schinzel. So that's a natural threshold. That is what Heath Brown was able to beat in the case of square free moduli. So getting 5/8. So we are in the complementary situation of prime power moduli. What we get is 11/18 by a very much different method. I wanted to make a link to the Oppenheim. That comes here. Good, of course, some equidistribution result like that implies the existence of solutions in particular, which is summarized in this corollary. Okay, we have solutions where x1, x2, x3 are all less than q to the 11/18 plus epsilon, no matter how we choose alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3. Okay, so what is the link to the Oppenheim conjecture from which we came actually? So quantitative versions of the Oppenheim conjecture establish the existence of solutions, approximating some given sigma by a distance of less than delta. And we would like to get x1, x2, up to xn as small as possible. So we would like to get a function of delta and show the existence of solutions of this inequality for x1 up to xn less or equal this function of delta. A particular case is approximations of zero. So sigma is equal to zero. So that was established by Davenport and Heilbronn long time back in the 60s, using a variant of the circle method. So here the circle method comes in. Otherwise, my talk is a little bit away from the main theme of this conference, but the circle method plays a role. Yeah, so now one can look at our problem as one can understand it as a periodic version of the quantitative, of a quantitative Oppenheim conjecture. So in this case, we can reformulate our problem as finding solutions x1 up to xn such that the periodic norm of q x1 up to xn is small, less than delta. And we would like to find a function n of delta so that we can establish the existence of a solution x1 up to xn, where the maximum of those x1 up to xn is less or equal n of delta. No, that is the usual. Yeah, so actually we mix two norms. We mix the periodic norm and the usual norm. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, so trying to establish some periodic analog of the Oppenheim conjecture is our quantitative Oppenheim conjecture leads precisely to our problem. And interesting is it complements Heath Brown's setup. So I talk now about the method. It's instructive to look at a particular case, which I mentioned already earlier, Pythagorean triples. Then we see easily how the method works. In fact, we worked this out first and also put it on the archive, but didn't publish that and then published the general result. Okay. Good. In this case, our congruence takes this form. So now important to note is we get some trivial solutions already where x1, x2, x3 are small compared to the square root of the modulus. Namely, in the case when we assume they are all less than square root of q half, then necessarily the congruence turns into an equation. That means then we count exactly Pythagorean triples. For that, asymptotics are known. So we will get some asymptotic like a constant depending on the p, which takes care of the coprimality condition, times n log n. So that's a very different asymptotic to the asymptotic which we get for q larger than square root of the n larger than the square root of the modulus. So let me go back to this. Yeah, so here we get in that range, we get basically n to the 3 divided by q. So in the range around q to the 1/2, the two will meet. So that's a kind of transition range, which is interesting in itself. I come back to that later. All right. So this shows also that q to the 1/2 is a natural limit. So we cannot expect anything like this asymptotic. Yeah, this asymptotic n to the 3 over q for q smaller than q to n smaller than q to the 1/2. Okay, so we need to assume in any case n greater than the square root of the modulus. Okay, so let's illustrate a method at this particular case. Yeah, so what we do first is we parameterize the solutions of our congruence. In fact, they come from solutions of this equation, the usual circle equation in the periodic integers. And then it can be restricted to modulo p to the n. Good, in affine coordinates, the circle equation takes that form. And then, so there's a well-known parametrization of the k rational points. In our case, k is equal to the periodic. QP. So this can be parametrized in this form. This is very well known. So we get a parametrization by a one parameter family depending on T. In this way, so from that we get also a parametrization modulo P to the N. Okay, so now we can rewrite our quantity in question. So we set y1 equal to q1 x3 inverse, y2 equal to x2 x3 inverse, modulo p to the n. And then the quantity takes this form. Then we perform a Poisson summation in y1 and y2. Very simple. And so then we get, in the exponential actually e of pn x3 times k1 y1 plus k2 y2. And now we have our parametrization. That means we can parametrize that as a rational function in t modulo p to the n. Now, this can be evaluated completely. So there are very general theorems by Cochrane and Jiang on complete exponential sums with rational functions, modulo prime powers. So we do a complete evaluation of this exponential sum. It leads to a bit complicated expressions, but in the end, everything will turn into a dual problem, which looks quite similar to the original problem, as you would expect, as it usually happens. And so now our main term actually pops out already in a natural way. So by T0, we denote a zero frequency, K1, K2 equal to zero. So now our summation variables are X3. That's still left like it is. And we have K1, K2. Okay, so that's very easy to evaluate. It boils down to a counting problem. So we have here some, so we have the exponentials one, and we need to count t's, which satisfy this coprimality condition. So in the case of Pythagorean triples, it takes a particularly simple form. And we arrive at the desired main term. So now we need to bound the remaining contribution of K1, K2 not equal to zero. So now I omit a whole chunk of technical details. What we are doing is, we evaluate this exponential sum over T completely. And then we perform another Poisson summation in X3. And we end up with some dual problem. So we can bound this error contribution in that form. And you see here the same congruence appears again. However, the range of the variables has changed. So basically, so the most interesting case is r equals zero. So in this case, it's just basically the modulus divided by n. We would expect precisely that to happen. Okay, so now we can take advantage of the fact that if LR is small, so this range for L1, L2, L3, then this congruence is nothing else than an equation. So that is what we simply do. I have written that down here. If LR is less than that, then this congruence turns simply into an equation. And we have even asymptotic formulas for the number of solutions of this equation. Okay, so then we get a bound, which is of that form. And we observe that This is dominated by the main term. If n is greater or equal than the basically the square root of the modulus. So in this case, we get an asymptotic formula. Things become more complicated in a general case, but work along the same lines. I just have written down what happens when we perform all that. So here we start with this quantity. So everything is the same, just the quadratic form has changed. Good. So we want to also make a notation. We want to define the corresponding quantity with sharp cutoff summation in that form. Instead of smooth functions, we take just the characteristic function of interval from minus one to n. So that means x1, x2, x3 run up to n. Okay, so then we get this expression. So here you see the main term coming out. That's the error term. So, and here you see the dual sums occur. In this case, the quadratic forms are of the same form, but the coefficients have changed into alpha 2, alpha 3, alpha 1, alpha 3, and alpha 1, alpha 2. Good. So now the task is to bound this dual quantity from above. If we have a fixed form from the very beginning, alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3 are fixed, then it's as easy as before. So this congruence in the dual problem will turn into an equation. But so more interesting is when we have arbitrary coefficients, so they can have size as large as the modulus, basically. So then this argument, the simple argument fails, and we need something more clever. That's where the most interesting thing happens. Okay, so it's relatively easy to establish a bound of this dual quantity, like m to the 3/2 plus epsilon, independent of the modulus. This would lead precisely to an asymptotic in the case when n is greater or equal to q to the 2/3 plus epsilon. So that's the natural threshold, 2/3. So we would like to beat that. So what would be the trivial bound? Good. So trivial would be m square. When we have two variables, then the last one is basically fixed by the congruence. So m to the 3/2 is already non-trivial, but not difficult to obtain. But we want to beat that to get an improvement. So the method is kind of, reminds to the division into minor and major arcs in the circle method. So we may write our congruence in that form. So we just take the beta 3 to the left-hand side, take the inverse. And it turns out our method depends on the Diophantine properties of B1, B3 inverse divided by Q, and B2, B3 inverse divided by Q. Okay, so we divide into two cases. Basically, one case where we can use the strategy boiling down things to an equation instead of a congruence. And the other case uses some, uses reduction to linear exponential sums, in fact. Okay, so in this, the first case is when both fractions have good rational approximation by rational numbers with small denominator. In this case, we can reduce the congruence to an equation. So here gamma 1, gamma 2 are small, and this k is also small. So, yeah. Of course, we can write the congruence as quadratic form is equal to KQ. That is what we are doing. And we make a reduction based on this rational approximation. And the point is we get this gamma 1, gamma 2, very small. Okay. And we use a simple counting argument to bound the number of solutions of that. Yeah, so we fix x3 and then the number of x1, x2 satisfying this equation is bounded by m to the epsilon. That is what we are doing. But this can be refined. So I come to that point later. So it's natural to actually try the circle method to get a better estimation for the number of solutions of this equation here. All right. Yeah, in a complementary case, I also avoid technicalities. I just say what we are doing is we use the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality in a certain way. Basically, we we take maybe I can write. So what we are doing is we want to bound x1, x2, x3. In z to the 3, that's equal m in this case. This m will be smaller than the square root of the modulus, will be of size modulus divided by n, the original n. So m is equal to 2 divided by n. Okay, and then beta 1. X1 square plus beta 2. Or let me write it. Yeah, okay. Square plus beta 3. X3 square is congruent 0 modulo Q. Okay, so 1. And then what we do is we let M be the set of minus beta 3, x3 square modulo q. And then, by the size of these variables, we will hit any element at most twice, any element of m. So this is actually equal to 2 times. M element M, then X1, X2, and Z square. So M, and then beta 1, X1 square, plus beta 2, X2 square, congruent M. Mod Q. Okay, and then we apply the Cauchy-Schwarz inequality. Okay, so this is less cardinality of M to the 1/2 plus times element M. Square of this inner sum here. Oh yeah, I dropped the coprimality condition. Let's forget about that now. Beta 1 x1 square plus beta 2 x2 square m. Mod Q. Okay, and then we square out. And what we get is less m to the 1/2. So quadruples x1, x2, x3, x4, element z. 4. So then the height conditions, xi less or equal m. And then two congruences, beta 1, x1 square. And then additional summation over m, element m. M mod q. And then here similarly, beta 1 x3 square plus beta 2 x4 square, congruent m mod q. Okay, and then we just forget about the m. So we can write this in the form beta 1 x3 square plus beta 2 x4 square mod q. We lose a bit in that step, of course. But now we can boil down the whole thing to linear congruences by just taking differences. And then yeah, things boil down nicely to something which we can handle. Okay, it takes this form here. So we can isolate some diagonal contribution, which is this quantity again, but raised to the first power. And then we get linear congruences of this form here. And now one can proceed in a usual way by picking out a congruence using additive characters. And now one can make use of the property of the rational, of the Diophantine property of the quotient of this coefficient and Q. In fact, there's an earlier result by another PhD student of mine and myself, where we exactly treat this kind of sums, solutions of linear equations with A and B in some box. So the result which we get is that here, depending on rational approximation of this quotient. So if this is approximated by A divided by R plus O of 1 divided by R square, then we obtain a saving. So the important term here is M square divided by R. So the trivial bound would be M square, and we get a saving if R is not too small. Okay, yeah, so this appeared in a completely different context in this earlier work. Good, so then we can put both things together, both contributions of the two cases. We choose the parameters suitably. And in the end, we arrive at that estimate. And it can be checked easily if m is less or equal q to the 1 half minus epsilon. Then this beats this bound m to the 3 half plus epsilon. And we can easily calculate. It gives an asymptotic for our original problem if n is greater or equal 11 over 18 plus epsilon. So just to make a comparison, so Heath-Brown's coefficient is exponent is 0.625. And this is slightly better. Okay. Yeah, so now I made a remark, which leads already to the problems, which I want to state. So we saw that at some point we encountered this equation here. So here, x1, x2, x3 run over a rather large range, less or equal m. Q is, yeah, a little smaller than m square. Gamma 1, gamma 2 are rather small. And also we are allowed to let k run over some small range. So a natural approach to that would be the circle method. So now there is a lot of work about integer representations of by ternary quadratic forms. So the circle method alone is not sufficient. But yeah, some spectral methods can be used to actually get non-trivial results, some asymptotic for the number of representations of an integer by, let's say, x1 square, x2 square, x3 square. So what happens actually if one carries this out is the following. Eventually, one encounters Salier sums, which can be evaluated explicitly. So in these terms of the form E of hx divided by c are contained, where x is a solution of a quadratic congruence of the form x square is congruent d modulo c. And what one needs is averages over c. So that means one needs to deal with sums of that form. C in some range, let's say, or let's take a weight function, WC, X square congruent D modulo C, D fixed, E of HX divided by C. So that is highly non-trivial because number of solutions is very small compared to C. Yeah, so there's a long paper. Good, so there are many results about equidistribution of quadratic congruences. In particular, there is a result of a long paper of Duke Friedlander Ivanitz who use spectral methods for fixed D, but D they want to allow as large as they can. Basically, not just a small d. Yeah, such non-trivial estimates of these averages lead to some saving, which gives us an asymptotic for the number of solution of the ternary quadratic equation. Okay. Yeah, suddenly that is one thing to look at. Getting some improvement of this exponent 11 over 18 by exploiting that. I want to draw your attention to one interesting paper by Friedlander and Ivanitz about small representations by indefinite ternary quadratic forms. So they look precisely at the case of Pythagorean triples. So definite ternary quadratic forms are easier than indefinite. So here they look at this particular most easy indefinite quadratic form, and they are interested in small solutions of this equation here. So they use not directly the circle method, it's more a direct approach, but again, things boil down to these sums which I wrote on the board. Okay, and then they can use directly their results, their early results. On this question. Yeah, so that's something which I look at the moment. Good, so now problem session number three. So I state a number of open problems. Partly my PhD student works on these questions, partly me. And certainly something will be left also for the audience. Yeah, so one thing, as I mentioned, improves this exponent 11 over 18. So then things become more interesting actually, because yeah, so that's highly interesting equidistribution of solutions of quadratic congruences as we vary the modulus. So that comes into play if we want to improve that exponent. Yeah, so then it would be interesting if it is possible actually to merge both Heath-Brown's method and our method. So Heath-Brown uses character sums over binary quadratic forms. So he takes a primitive character chi and then varies x, y and considers the sum over chi of q, x, y. So that's the tool which he uses in his paper, very much different from what we are doing. Yeah, is it possible to somehow merge these two to treat general moduli? Then, yeah, so my PhD student looks now at a natural question, generalize that from diurnal quadratic forms to arbitrary quadratic forms in three variables. Then, of course, another natural question, can we treat the case n greater 3 more than three variables along similar lines? But in fact, three variables is most interesting. That's the most difficult case, certainly. I want to look at, or we want to look at Pythagorean triples. Especially in that case, so what happens in this transition range of q to the 1/2? So in this case, we may rewrite our congruence in that form. X2 square minus x3 square is equal to k q, where k is small. So it is better to, it's natural to, instead of considering the congruence itself, consider this equation with these variables running and also that running over some small intervals. And then let's see what we can do with this method of Friedlander-Ivanitz. D assume actually that to be D square free. That we don't have here, we have a highly non-square free thing, namely kp to the n. But nevertheless, their method can be used, and in fact, it boils down then to congruences of that form, x square congruent. Let's say n is even for simplicity. Then it boils down to these congruences naturally. So we can basically club together the p to the 2, p to the n with the x. So again, then we are down to quadratic congruences with this k being very small. Okay, and then we can use one of the results in the literature about distribution of these solutions. So that as a starting point also to the improvement of the exponent 11 over 18 for general quadratic forms. Let's just look first at the Pythagorean triples. That's a reasonable thing to do. Very much different are inhomogeneous congruences. So then we need new ideas. And they have received, so there are also some results about that in the literature, but they have received less attention. And very interesting, instead of quadratic congruences, let's take cubic congruences, for example. So for example, what happens if we have some elliptic curve? So when we consider exponent 3, then can we proceed along similar lines? So can we use rational points on elliptic curves? So that is all of open problems. Maybe as another possibility to do something. Let's, for example, consider that here. Instead of square, we take cubed congruent 0 modulo q x1, x2, x3. X1. Do you just want to have higher degree polynomials on the forms on the left hand side? And that may be linked to elliptic curves over QP. But okay, something to look at. Yeah, so That's all. So the literature. Yes. So very important was this paper here, evaluation of complete exponential sums, the Fresnel functions. Then the Heath-Brown paper, that one from 2016, where he gets this exponent 5/8. Yeah, so then what I referred to in the end, the paper by Friedländer Ivanets on integer representations by indefinite ternary quadratic forms. Okay, thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much for a nice lecture. So, any question?
Yeah. That is another interesting problem to look at. Yes. I think there's something also for the Oppenheim conjecture with two quadratic forms. Yeah, yes. Or one quadratic form, one linear form also. Yeah, that's another interesting problem to look at. Extending the number of quadratic forms. Yeah. Hmm? Yeah, yes, yes. Hmm.
So, any other question?
Oh, there is some question in the.
Hello? Hello? Hello?
Yeah, hello, yes.
I wanted to ask, is there any like analog statements in homogeneous dynamics of this
problem? In homogeneous what?
Dynamics.
Dynamics.
Yeah. Mm. Like related to the orbit of certain groups in.
You mean? I mean, so I'm not familiar with the dynamical methods. So you mean some ergodic theoretic approach to that?
Yeah, something about the something about it mostly connects to the problem about the orbit of certain groups like SO1, 2 or anything like that in the homogeneous space, right?
Okay.
Problems like this usually. So does there exist anything like that? Anyway.
Yeah, maybe possible. I have not looked at that, and I'm. I have to say I'm very classical.
Okay, thanks.
Yeah. So at the beginning of the lecture, you talk the small solution. Is it small in terms of height?
Yeah. So I can go back to that. So I mean, so the height, natural height, is or canonical height is given by this maximum. So we want to have x1, x2, x3 in a small range compared to the modulus. So typically in a range q to the theta. The theta is small, so 1/2 is a natural barrier or limit of every method. But so the goal would be to reach 1/2. We have reached 11/18, a bit larger.
Yeah, I have another question. When you started the upper bound for dual problem,
mm-hmm.
you have taken some x1 square plus x2 square equal to something to x3. You said that the number of choices of x1, x2 is big of m per epsilon. Could you please explain that one?
That one, yes. Okay, yeah, yes. Mm-hmm. Okay, we basically want the number of solutions of Na gut, let's consider a very simple case. So gamma 1 x1 square plus gamma 2 x2 square equal to, okay, so we fix the x3 and let's say that is equal to n here on the right hand side. And we count the number of solutions of that simply, and that is small. Yeah, let's take very simple cases if gamma 1 is 1, gamma 2 is minus 1, then you just get a factorization into x1 minus x2, x1 plus x2 equals n, and then you count divisors. And similarly, if you have x1, gamma 1 is equal to 1, gamma 2 is equal to 2, you get x1 plus I x2 times x1 minus I x2 equal n. Okay, then you count factorizations in Zi. And similarly, in general, you need to consider a suitable quadratic number field to bound the number of solutions. So it boils down to counting divisors of ideals in number fields, quadratic number fields. But we've certainly lost something because we just sum up over x3 then trivially. And we can certainly do better using the circle method and these results about quadratic congruences. Yeah. Prime variables. Okay, so that's also very interesting. I'm not aware of, yes, okay, Waring's problem with prime variables, Goldbach-Waring problem for quadratic forms. Yeah, that has been dealt with. But I don't know who, actually. I don't remember who, but I know that received a lot of extension also, a lot of attention. Good, then one can consider the same for congruences. That I don't know if that has been considered. Also, Oppenheim conjecture has been considered for prime variables by Harman in particular. Yeah, that's another interesting suggestion.
Yeah.
Okay.
So
a lot of open problems.
Any other question? So if there is no further question, so let us thank the speaker again. Once again.
Thank you.